Recording the session now. All right, and now, Fabio, you should be able to turn both your camera on and your audio on. Can you hear me, Fabio? You'll see a little microphone icon on the top left corner of your on the bottom left corner of your screen. There you go. Yeah, awesome. Yeah. Hello, Fabio.
Hello, everybody. Hola, ¿qué tal?
Muy bien, mucho gusto. This is Fabio. I want to introduce him as an amazing ocarina player and somebody who knows very, very much about history. He has studied and is just an incredible resource of knowledge about the ocarina. And I really want to hope that we give him a great welcome here to Ocarina Fest Day 1. He is doing a presentation about ocarina history, a very important topic that I hope you guys enjoy learning from him. Hello, Fabio.
Hello, everybody. I feel very honored to be here with you. From so far away, I am from Bologna, from my house. Now it is 5 p.m. here in Italy. So I think in the U.S. it is in morning. We are in the late afternoon. It is a cloudy day today in Bologna. It was raining. Do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Okay. Great, Fabio. Thank you again for being here. And I'm going to go ahead and let you take it away with your presentation about ocarina history. And we're so excited to have you here. Thank you again for being here, Fabio. Muchas gracias.
Thank you to you for inviting me. As I told you, it's a big honor for me. I take with me some pieces that I will show you one by one from beginning. First of all, forgive my English because I'm not mother language, so I speak a little of continental European English, and I hope you will understand me. This is a whistle with the shape of a goose, because I don't know if you know that ocarina in Italian means little goose. Oca is a goose, ina is the suffix for little. So little goose, and this is a modern little goose made of clay, made by my friend Benvenuto Fecchio. It has only a couple of holes, one here and one here, and it can make a few notes. It was not thought to be a musical instrument, but just a toy. It was very common in Italy in the 19th century, and there were different shapes of animal, but the most common was the shape of the goose. That is why the ocarina take name from this kind of whistle. But a young man from Budrio, that is a village close to Bologna, about 20 kilometers east to Bologna, from Bologna. His name was Giuseppe Donati. I think that most of you have heard about him. Decided to make a whistle with a different shape. First, he made something with the shape of an egg, like this, like more or less like this, that I bought years ago in Romania. But he put many holes on it, so he can make more interesting melodies. I wanted to play Satchmo song, but I have not enough note with this. It was not very easy to play because it has many holes on the little surface. So he decided to make an experiment to make a more linear instrument. First, he made something like a trumpet, but the structure broke, and the final shape was this, that you know very well. Good light, okay, here. This is an original Giuseppe Donati ocarina. It was made in 1860, I think, 1870s, because it is made without using molds, but just using the hands. So it is one of the very first ones that Donati made. And it's one of the very first ocarina that existing in the world, I think. And this comes from the Budrio Ocarina Museum. I take it for you. It plays very well, even if it is very old. It has only 9 holes, no hole here. It is a G2. And this means that Donati begin to make ocarina in different shape, but they were not different shape casually made, but they were made in order to be well harmonized, well tuned in, I think first they were tuned in B flat and F, B flat, B flat, F, and he made a quintet of instrument from the bass to the small one, and with his friends that were all member of the band of the town of Budrio, they made the first ocarina ensemble. It was about 1865. We have a documentation about this music activity, because we have a newspaper from that year. And in this newspaper, they talk about a trial against the ocarina player, because they played during the night and it was forbidden. So someone denounced them, and they had to pay money for this. It was not a good beginning, but it was a beginning for the ocarina players. So I think that the most important thing for Giuseppe Donati is that it's not to that he made an ocarina, but that he made a family of ocarinas, because with the family, Donati and his friend begin to play first in Italy, then abroad in all Europe, and the ocarina became a well-known instrument all over Europe. In fact, the first maker out of Italy, out of Budrio, was the Austrian Heinrich Fien. Probably you know his ocarinas, because they are very common also in eBay. They are quite cheap. And I got one here. Usually they are black, but this one was very played, very, very used. So it loses the color black. It has also this metal tuner, you see. You put out it before playing, and the sound go down. And if you put it inside, the sound go up, because the volume of the air inside the instrument change. Half a tone of difference, but there is half a tone on the high notes, and there is less different on the lower notes. So I think that this is not very, very useful because the tuning changes in different ways. Yes, about the semitone, Eric, David, but only on the high note. Another interesting maker is, how to open it? Yeah. This one is made by Ercole Mezzetti, that was from Budrio. He was a friend of Donati. He was a member of the first Ocarina group that at the beginning was a quintet, then became a septet now today. And this is an ocarina made by Mezzetti. They are quite difficult to find now, and not like Fien that are very common. We have many in the museum, and you see the double hole to make the flat, flat D. There's a very nice box made of, probably made of paper. So the ocarina was beginning to be more and more popular. There was a market of ocarina players that wanted to have this instrument. And a French maker decided to make ocarina with metal. It was, I think, about 1890s. Mr. Charles Mathieu in Paris made a factory to make ocarina made of metal. You can also find in eBay some pieces of this kind. They are quite common. For me, they don't play very well, but it was, I think it's important to know that at the end of 19th century, about 130 years ago, there was a market of ocarina players, and some maker decided that it was the moment to make ocarina more fast and at lower price. So as the plastic didn't exist anymore, he could do only with metal by machine and not by hand like the ocarinas that are made by in clay. Go on. This is the, I think, the very first ocarina made of plastic. It is made in America, in the US, in the 40s. Probably you know about this ocarina. You are from the US, so I think that it's quite well known, this history. The American government decided to make thousands and thousands of ocarinas, different sizes, I think, to give them to the American army that was fighting during the Second World War. So I think that this is very interesting because it make us know that the ocarina was quite popular at that time in the US. It was very popular in the 30s and the 40s. And so the American government made many ocarinas for the soldiers to have a better time while they were fighting. My grandfather, I took also some other pieces. This is a very nice ocarina made in Germany in a Meissen style. It's a porcelain ocarina. It doesn't play very well, I must say, but this is very, very beautiful instrument. This is a new plastic instrument. It plays very well. It is made with a 3D printer. I don't know the English term for that, but it is made by the Italian maker Fabio Menaglio from Budrio. And he makes also clay instrument and plastic instrument, but he makes not with molds, but with the printing machine. They play very well. Thank you. Another kind of ocarina is a four-hole ocarina. Well, there is a debate about these are ocarinas or not, because someone says that only with this shape we can say ocarina with 10 or 12 holes. But everybody also call ocarina the four-hole ocarina, four-hole clay instrument. This is a beer, you see, very nice, very gentle. I saw just a few seconds a question about the name of this instrument. Well, everybody calls these kind of instrument ocarina, but someone says that the shape of the ocarina is typically this, and this should be called clay flute more generally. My favorite one is this. You know this? It is a cup with four holes and one hole here and one little hole here where I blow. There are two cups, one inside and one outside. There are one outside as the holes. Teacup ocarina, I think this is made in Taiwan. And I want to show you also the, I think it is the most little musical instrument in the world. I cannot imagine a smaller musical instrument than this five holes ocarina. The part of those you drink in the morning, yes. It's possible to use as a cup to drink tea or water or whatever you want, and also to play something. It is difficult to see it when you play it. I think this comes from the United Kingdom. It was made by John Langley. I don't know the tuning, I don't remember, I should try. But it's very, very nice and very little and very loud sound. So these are some pieces that I've prepared. I must say something about the difference between the European 10 holes ocarina and the Asian 12 holes. I think that most of the ocarinas that are sold now in the world are with 12 holes. The 12 holes ocarina was invented in the 60s in Japan. By the Aketa company. Aketa was the first Japanese ocarina maker from the 40s, I think. So, yeah, yes, 30, 40s. And in the 60s, with the help of Mr. Kayama, that was a good musician that collaborated with Aketa, they developed an ocarina with 10 holes, with 12 holes, in order to make two notes more. I take one, sorry, I forget to take one. I come soon. I'm back. With a number one, you see the two little holes here. Where are them? Here. Do. So the middle finger and the index can close the two holes, and I go down to a low A. To make this, they made a bigger chamber ocarinas, yes, to La. And so this hole must be a little smaller than with the 10 holes ocarina. And usually the 12 holes have a sweeter sound, while the 10 holes have a louder sound. Another difference, the most important difference, is that the position of the high Mi is different, because with the 10 hole we make like this, that is more natural. Moving the little finger, re mi re mi. While with the Asian style, the big hole is for the thumb, and here I have the small hole. So if I play this, I make a E mi flat. Which one is better? I don't know. I think that I play usually the 10 holes because I'm more used to play the high Mi like this. I feel more easy and more fast. But many musicians use the different with the 12 holes. An advantage of the 12 holes is that you can play quite easily the sharp Do. Or flat Re, using this little finger, while with the 10 holes is very difficult to make the half hole with this finger. Usually, I suggest you, if you want to make a sharp Do, to use this system, to make like this with the ocarina and the sound go a little down. And of course, you must change the pressure of your blowing, and the sound go down, as typical of the ocarina. I can say something about the history of the multi-chamber ocarina. I cannot read the question, sorry. Maybe later. About the history of the multi-chamber ocarina. Well, they have become quite popular in the last 20 years. I think thank you to the music of Japanese famous player Satoshi Ozawa, that invented a way to play the double ocarina in a very creative way for jazz music, for solo like this. He's a saxophone player also. But I must say that this multi-chamber ocarina were invented many years ago, because we have some prototype of multi-chamber ocarina that were made at the beginning of the 20th century, or maybe at the end of 19th century in Italy, from different makers, from Cesare Vicinelli and also Donati and also Silvestri and maybe Avati, different makers, different town of Italy. And they all had in their catalog the double ocarina, that is the same that now is very popular in Asia. So I don't think that they have copied, but I think they have the same idea in different places of the world. So I gave I told what I think that can be interesting about the history of ocarina. If there are questions, I will be very glad to try to answer. And forgive again my English.
I think one of the questions that you had, by the way, thank you for your presentation. That was extremely informative. I was really delighted to listen. Very, very good. I loved it very much. I wanted to say one of the questions you had gotten was asking about the fipple or the windway. It was asking about the angle of the breath during one of the times that you were playing. So they were asking if it had to do with that. And then another question you had was, what area of the world is ocarina most popular in as an instrument?
Well, the ocarina, as I told, was invented in Italy, in northern Italy, in Budrio. And I must say you a spoiler you that very, very probably next year at the end of April, like every time, there will be the Ocarina Festival in Budrio. Some of you have been there. It's very, very nice to meet there. And there is a big market of ocarina makers. There are concerts in the night and the afternoon everywhere. So keep in touch. And I think that at the end of April 2023, there will be an edition of Ocarina Festival. So see you in Budrio. But the place where the ocarina has become more popular was Japan. This is thank you to the activity of a great musician like Sojiro. Probably you heard of this name. Sojiro began to make music and recording in the 80s. He made recording with orchestra and with different group. He's very famous in Japan. He made more than 30 CD, I think. And I was years ago to a concert, and it was very successful. And so thank you to Sojiro, the ocarina became very popular in Japan since 30 years ago, more or less. And there are other musicians like Satoshi Ozawa and many others that are also ocarina teacher. And so I think that in Japan there are about 100,000 ocarina players or something like this. Most of them are women. And after Japan, the ocarina has arrived to Taiwan and then to Korea and then to continental China. And so I must say that the place where ocarina is more played and more popular is Far Asia, Far East. It is also quite, I think that it's becoming more popular little by little also in Europe. And as you can tell me, also yeah. In the US, it is an instrument for young generation, I think. Thank you to Zelda and other.
Yeah, that was a really good question. Leo asked that. There was another follow-up question saying, is that how we have 12-hole Japanese and Taiwanese styles of ocarinas? Where you were mentioning that there was a lot of popularity in the Japanese ocarina playing and also in Taiwanese ocarina playing. Is that related to the naming conventions of Japanese style and Taiwanese style?
Oh, I'm not sure that I understand the question. You are asking me about the style of playing ocarina in these countries.
Oh, I think they are asking more specifically about the style of subhole, such as whenever there is a 12-hole ocarina and the subholes are placed on the right hand. That's sometimes they call that the Japanese style, and then sometimes the style of 12-hole ocarina, and sometimes calling the Taiwanese style of ocarina with the two on each thumb side. Let me see if I have a something to show of that.
You are talking about something that I don't know exactly.
Oh, that's no worries. That's no worries. I think they were just asking about if you knew anything about the styles in regards
To play ocarina with the hands on the same side. No, not possible, I think.
Let me see if I could find it. I could probably show. Sorry, I'm having a hard time finding mine. But either way, that is probably something like this that I could find. So for instance, in this ocarina,
yeah,
with the holes, some of the holes are right down here, right? So some of these holes.
Okay. The position of the sub holes.
Right. That.
Yeah.
Of the sub holes.
Well, I have many ocarina from Asia. I took this. This is from Korea. You recognize this typical of Nobel from Hongseong, Korea, South Korea. And this has two sub holes for the right hand, both from the for the right hand. But most of the sub holes are one with the middle. Middle finger of the right hand and the middle finger of the left hand. I think Japanese style is this. Also in China, I think most of ocarinas two sub holes, but the technique is the same.
Right.
Also
right.
In China, they made with the two hands. That.
Right. And
this is typical of Nobel, I think.
Yeah. And that's a really nice noble ocarina. I love looking at it and I enjoyed hearing. It was very, very good. One other question that you had from Elliot. Elliot was asking, do you have any suggestions for websites to buy ocarinas or ocarina sheet music?
Well, if you go to the Ocarina Network, you can find many suggestions about this. I cannot say that a maker is better than another, and there are different styles, and I suggest to begin with Alto C. That is the most common ocarina. You can find also cheap ones. Don't buy too much cheap, because plastic ones very cheap don't play well, but the most famous ocarina brand have a very good quality of instrument. So
another question that you had from David was, do you know when Giuseppe Donati started to use molds?
I'm not sure, but I think about 1880s. But we have no documents about this. I just can say that the ocarina that he made at the beginning are very different from the one that he made when he was in Milan, because he moved to Milan in 1890s. And the shape is different, they're completely different. So they are made with molds, and these are not made with molds. But I cannot say exactly when. I think nobody can say.
Thank you, Fabio. Thank you, Meister. We appreciate you a lot. We had, I think, another question here from Chris. Chris wanted to know, in your opinion, do you think that the rise of popularity of ocarina in the US due to Zelda is hurting or helping the reputation of the instrument?
I'm not against this approach to ocarina. I think that when you begin to play, then you can discover a complete world. So after Zelda, you can see much more, and Zelda is a good key to enter in the world of ocarina.
I love that. That's very well put. I love that, Maestro. Thank you so much.
Thank you to you.
We got another question from Jack. Do you know who is the one teacher that sends a lot of students to the Budryo competition? I think he was referring to somebody in Taiwan that sends a teacher in Taiwan?
Well, I don't remember the names of you write about a competition. I know that there is a competition organized by my friend Emiliano with a Temporale Association, and also this year there will be there is now the competition, and it ends, I think, at the end of October, and I hope that many people will join, because to compete is also a way to compete with ourselves and to get better, mostly than compete with others, to have a reason to study and to go better and better. I know that many musicians came from Taiwan last year, because I was a member of the jury, and also this year, I think. But I don't know the name of the teacher.
Okay.
I don't remember.
Thank you so much, Maestro. I wanted to say also, my question to you would be, can you tell us about the Budro Ocarina Festival, if anybody here wanted to attend that, or also the concerto competition? Can you tell us a little bit more about that before we finish our session?
Well, what I can say is that I talked with the Budro major a few days ago. There is a young girl that is a new Budro major since a few months, and she told me that she wanted to do the festival next year, because it was 3 years that we don't make the festival, and the last one was in 2019. So because of COVID, we stopped everything, as everywhere in the world. And now, if things go better like this, so we can do it, but it's not usually it is at the end of April, but I cannot say who will come at the moment, because we are very early.
I completely understand that. Yes,
we're trying. But to also bring... if you have been to Budrio, you can have an idea of what it was. A lot of people playing from all over the world, everywhere in this little village. It was nice.
Yes,
and it will be.
I can't wait. I really can't wait to see it. I myself have never been to a Budrio festival, but I really want to go to the next one, or whichever I'm able to go to as soon as possible. And can you tell us lastly about the concerto competition?
Concerto competition, I suggest you to look for Il Temporale. The name is Il Temporale, the association that the music school that organizes the competition. It is possible to make videos. The video must be not cut, and live video, like if it was in a physical presence there. But they begin with the COVID, and it was not possible to move to Italy, so it is a online competition, but you must send your video. There are two categories, one for professional, one for amateur, with prizes of money and ocarinas, and it's I think one of the most important ocarina competition in the world. It has already, I think this is edition number 4, so it's a quite good history at high level.
Yes. Thank you so much again, Maestro, for sharing your knowledge with us, and also thank you for sharing about the festival, and also about concerto competition. We are very lucky and very glad that our schedules line up, that you could help us with this session and also bring us really great historical knowledge about the ocarina. I hope everybody learned a lot. I am very, very happy with our session. And a lot of people in the chat are thanking you. They're saying thank you very much for presenting. Have a wonderful evening. It must be amazing going somewhere. This was referring to the festival. It must be amazing going somewhere where others play ocarina as well. Thank you, Fabio. Thank you. It was very informative. So we thank you very, very much from Global Ocarina Community. We thank you. And we hope to see you again at the next festival or whenever we see you next time, or if we see you in Budrio.
Okay, play together. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Maestro Fabio. Thank you.
Bye bye.
Have a wonderful night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Okay, well, I'm very, very thankful to everybody and exceptionally thank you to Maestro Fabio. We had a really, really fun, fun session about ocarina history. I hope everybody learned a lot from the video and also learned a lot by listening. I'm really excited. Like I said, going to Budrio has been one of my dreams for a little bit, and I can't wait until that's a possibility. I want to also go back to a comment that was said. It was the one that I think Sam had said, it must be amazing going somewhere where others can play the ocarina. Well, I'll tell you what, in the US, we are trying to start back up our ocarina community. Like Fabio was saying, and like you guys asked him, there is a lot of ocarina communities that are very active in Asia and in Europe, and we're trying to make the US ocarina community just as active, because we have a lot of people that play ocarina here in the US, but we just don't have a place for them to gather. So like I said, if you're interested in helping make this festival that's happening virtually an in-person festival, we are doing a Kickstarter tomorrow, and we are going to start that to go 100% of those donations go towards booking the venue. We, the volunteers, I put in a lot of hours making this festival happen, whether it's online or in person, and none of our volunteers get paid. We just really want to push the ocarina and try to get more people to know about it and people to have a community based around it. So I just wanted to encourage you guys, if you see that Kickstarter and you feel like supporting that, we need only 1500 to book that venue for 4 days here in North Texas. Feel free to let us know. And if you're able to support, we would really appreciate it. Whatever contribution you give would be fine. You could give 10 or 20 or anything that you are capable of giving if you want to support. And also watch out for any other in-person festivals that you see, like the Budrio Festival. Be sure to attend that one as well. That one is a wonderful festival. I have heard lots about it, and I can't wait to attend myself. So I cannot wait to launch that Kickstarter tomorrow. It goes live tomorrow, so I'll be really, really excited to help with that. I'll be donating some of my personal funds as well, and I'll be putting in last year's donations. Last year we raised 16%, which means we raised about $250. So I'll be putting that right in as soon as that Kickstarter gets launched. I'll be putting it in little by little. Thank you guys for all your questions for Maestro Galliani. Thank you so much, Maestro Galliani, for being here. We had a lot of fun learning and helping us with our panel for Ocarina History. Coming up next, we're going to have David Eric Ramos, who's going to be talking about performing on the ocarina and being an ocarina performer. David Eric Ramos is an amazing performer, and I have both seen him and met him a few times, and I'm really excited for his session because he's going to be really discussing a lot about what it's like to perform on the ocarina and a lot of things related to performance. So if you ever have had any questions about that, please definitely let me know. And I think Fabio is leaving us a link for the ocarina competition. So definitely check that out. It's Il Temporale Ocarina, RAVE. So check that out. That is really, really a good competition. I've competed in that before. I loved competing it. I had a great experience. I recorded the videos and submitted my video to be able to practice. I practiced for hours and hours, and it made me such a better player. I will say one of my better experiences is being able to be a part of that concerto competition, which is why I was asking. Obviously, I wasn't one of the winners, but I was competing with myself, like Fabio had said. Competing with yourself is the best type of competition because you're really competing with your former self, the first self that kind of started deciding, I'm going to sign up for this and I'm going to try to improve my playing to get to that point. And then at the very end, you come up with a video. It may not be perfect, but it's a really good way to increase your skills and make your playing much, much better. A lot of people usually ask, how much do I practice? I try to practice 1 to 2 hours per day, if I can. Not every day I can, but practicing is a really good way, and having a goal is a really good way to get your playing and your skills up. So I just really want to stress that if you really are interested in it, Fabio left us a link. I'm going to be sharing this link on Facebook so that everybody gets a chance to participate and take a look at it. Definitely find us on Facebook. I'm sharing that link again. Il Temporal Ocarina RAVE. We're going to go offline for about a couple of minutes and you'll see the screen of different presenters while David is getting his presentation together, and while we're just organizing and rearranging. So definitely check in with us at 11 for David's presentation. You won't want to miss it. It's really, really good. And I'll be playing a couple of more videos from our Ocarina community playlist. So here we go.
Tarasu. No, no. Sit. Stay. We nailed the squirrel. You sweet, wonderful dog. We nailed the squirrel this morning.
Thank you.
guys. I think, if I'm correct, I think David can hear me now, and he has the ability to talk and turn on his camera as well. Can you hear me, David? Testing, testing. All right, I think he'll be back in just a minute, but I'm gonna continue to, okay, perfect. I'm glad you guys can hear me. I'm gonna continue to share the playlist real quick while he continues to get set up. And yeah, very, very good. I love the comments I'm seeing on there. Thank you again so much for those kind comments. Just wanna say that that video took a while to make, so it's nice to know that y'all enjoyed it. That's really good. That video was You Can Become a Hero from My Hero Academia, and it's a show that's coming back really soon, interestingly enough. But yeah, I was looking at one of the comments saying I would love to get one of those really big ocarinas. I got that one from Imperial City Ocarina in Hong Kong. They are very, very price efficient for the contrabass C. The contrabass C, I love their contrabass C, so I do recommend it. David, can you hear me? David, are you there?
I am here. Give me just 1 second.
Okay, no worries. Take your time. We'll be here, okay? Just let me know when you're ready.
Thanks.
Hi there. My apologies. I didn't see the chat. But yes, we are ready. We will go back to yesterday. I promise we'll restart that. I'm sorry, Leo. Just to keep it to the time, I do apologize about that. But that is a really good song, and she plays it very, very well. We'll come back to it. David, you can hear me all right?
I sure can. Good morning, okay, everyone. Wonderful.
You have hosts, so you can turn your camera on.
Okay. Hello, hello.
Hey, David.
Let me attempt to share my screen. I think it's going to stop yours, Nicholas.
Oh, you're good.
Let's try this. All right, is it working? What do you
see? Sharing your screen, but I can't see anything on your screen.
All right, let me actually. Maybe that's wrong. Let's do a new share. Let's try this one. No, this one. How about now?
We can see it. Great.
All right. Perfect. Good morning, everybody. I was hoping to do this with some caffeine, but I did not finish making it. So I think I'm awake enough. How's everybody doing?
We're doing great. So, David, I feel like I introduce you all the time. So this time it's time to introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about who you are, even though everybody almost here, everybody knows you.
And yeah, hi, I'm David. I play the ocarina. It's what I do as a full-time job, thanks to my Patreon community. Shout out to them and that. I love playing the ocarina. I write music for the ocarina. I perform and I also teach. So this is the everything combined you're about to receive right now.
I love it. That's awesome. We're very excited to have you. Thank you again for being here, David. Always a pleasure to hear what you have to say and your work and about what you're doing.
Thank you. So this is going to be a little participatory. There's going to be lots of questions for you all. So I'm eyeing the chat and be as vocal as possible. So I'm going to be talking about performing with the ocarina. I'm glad to see so many performers here because I think this is as much for you as it is for anybody. And I'm also constantly learning. So if you guys have tips about this, I would love to hear them. So how many performers do we have in here? Just type one in the chat. Perfect. There's a good amount of everybody. One kinda. I can put your mind at ease that if you play for at least one other person, I'm going to consider you a performer. And we're going to actually address that. That's perfect, Sam. Sam said, I would love to perform, but lack the Triforce of Courage. That's amazing. That you're exactly who needs to be in this. All right. So next question. Why do we perform? Give me a couple reasons. Why do we perform for others? Or even for ourselves? I love that. Sharing the love for ocarina music, sharing the ocarina love. To tell a story. I love that, Nicholas. We like to share our passion with others. Yes. It helps me see myself as a more capable than I once believed. That is very poetic and lovely. Well, yes, we love to express ourselves. That's one of the reasons that I play the ocarina is it's my artistic way of expression. But we also love to share our passion and our art. I'm going to move this up here. We love to connect with others. I think that performance has been one of the easiest ways to connect with people, especially through storytelling and to make money. Like if you want to be a musician, this has to be part of the equation. I put it at the bottom because usually it is, but it is necessary. I love that answer, Fabio. All right. I think it's important to start off with this which isn't really a quote. This is just how I think how important it is. Performance is as much in your head as it is on the stage. And what I mean by that is that, as someone mentioned, they lack the triforce of courage. It takes courage to be able to get up on stage or in front of a crowd of people and to open yourself up and make yourself vulnerable to sharing something so deep. And so that's something that you're so passionate about. And so with that comes a lot of sometimes negative thinking and anxiety and stage fright. So I wanted to dive into that a little bit. I think it's very common. We all experience these at some point. What are some feelings that performers normally experience? I'll let you type that in the chat. What have you felt as a performer before going on stage, going on stage, and maybe even after your performance is done? Shaky hands and lack of breath. Yes, sweaty hands. Ooh, yeah. Feeling sick. Yeah, there's a lot of physical parts of this as well. An adrenaline hit, fear of judgment, potentially messing up several aspects. These are all very real, and I've felt every one of these. Excitement and nerves before, either satisfaction or regret for messing up after. Yes, these are all perfect answers. So anxiety or stage fright, that is a very common one, along with all the physical aspects that come up with that. So feeling sick, dizzy, sweaty hands, perspiration. and these are the thoughts that commonly are associated with that. What if I'm going to mess up? What if I didn't practice enough? What are they going to think of me? Are they going to judge me for how my performance is? Another one is imposter syndrome. I have felt this a lot throughout my entire career, just because I've seen how well other Ocarina players can use this instrument and the technical abilities that they have that I didn't have as a vocal performer, which is how I started out in college. And so even going to Budrio the first time and seeing how amazing everyone was, I was like, why am I here? But I've since overcome that, and I'm going to talk to you guys about how to do that as well. These are the thoughts that usually come up with that. I don't have enough experience for this. I'm not a good player. And the worst one is everyone else is better than me. So what are some things that we can do to alleviate those stresses that are sometimes not even true? Breathe and ground yourself. Breathing is the easiest one because everybody can do it. It's literally how we play the instrument. And just like when you're playing, I like to breathe deeply and from the diaphragm. So let's take a moment, everyone. Let's take a deep breath together on three. One, two, three. And then hold it for a second and release. It's as simple as that. That can reduce 10, 20% of your stress in a moment. So being able to do that when you're feeling this anxiety is huge. Reframing the situation. This is something I've actually learned in therapy that has been very helpful for me, is when you're telling yourself all these negative things, it's important to like look at it from what are the facts? What is the actual evidence and not what I'm just perceiving? So usually you have friends in the audience. Usually these people are excited about seeing you perform. Excuse me. Maybe you did practice a lot for this performance and you're prepared for it. And more times than not, everyone who's there wants to see you succeed. So some things you could say are like, I'm having these feelings because I care and I want to have a good performance. And that's a more positive spin on it. And it's a little more comforting. Or saying something like, the audience supports me and they want me to perform well. And both of those things are true. You can turn those into affirmations, like I'm prepared for this. I'm ready for this. I am a good player. This has also been something that's taken me a lot of practice to be able to talk to myself in this way, but it actually does help a lot. So I would highly recommend it. And then finally, visualization. So what you're trying to do is you are going to imagine your performance going well. And we're going to talk a little bit more about this in a second, but the goal behind this is to actually see yourself succeeding and performing it the way you want to, so that you have a roadmap and that you can follow through with it. If you just imagine what you're going to be doing on stage, which most performers should be doing in general, then you have more confidence. So just imagining yourself knocking this thing out of the park is very helpful. Some ways to get over the anxiety, I would say, is just performing every chance that you get, whether it's an open mic or you're playing with some friends. I've noticed that the more that I used to actually not enjoy performing because of the anxiety that I felt, but the more that I did it, the easier it got and the more confidence that I built. So perform every chance that you get. And if you mess up mid-performance, this is extremely important. Pretend it never happened. Just ignore it. And most likely nobody else caught it but you. I think we're our own worst critics. And so the instinct is to make a face like, or like jolt, like your body will respond in the moment to you knowing you did something wrong, but resist that and practice pushing through that as much as you can. Because if you point it out, more people are gonna notice. So it was a happy mistake and no one else is gonna remember it but you. So just keep playing. This part is probably the most heavy of the presentation. Fabio said, I think that the most important thing on stage is to think that the audience wants to have fun and you can have fun, help them have fun with your music. Yes, that is a very good point, Fabio. Steven said, 100%, there's so many times in the past where I used to let the mistakes get to me mid-performance, but that happens all the time to even professionals. So just keep playing and push through it. Many times people may not even notice. Yeah, most of the time if they notice, it's because I told them, like after the performance, I'm like, yeah, they're like, great job. And I was like, yeah, but I really messed up in that second, in that second part of the song. So don't do that. All right, so let's talk about preparation. So there are two levels to preparing for a performance, in my opinion, and each of those levels have different areas that you need to focus on. So the first is the part that everybody can do. It's just focusing on the music. And this is simply where you ask yourself, who is my audience? Let's say that you get a gig, or like, for instance, this Ocarina Fest, there's an open mic, I believe, tomorrow or Sunday. And so you're asking yourself, who is the audience? Well, in this case, there's probably a lot of video game and anime fans. So I'm going to select music that fits within that genre. And then you would assemble your set list off of that. And then you would just practice, right? Like, you don't have to memorize the music, but it would. By the way, I'm going to stop myself. Do you guys see the practice bullet, or is that just me? You should see it. Okay, great. You don't have to memorize the music, but when you're practicing, you're familiarizing yourself with it, right? So that way you're not figuring it out on stage. To me, that is where I've felt the most anxiety, is when I did not know the music and people see me struggling. So these are the two things that you're going to be working on the most, that you're going to be memorizing or familiarizing yourself with the music and practicing your technique. So that way you're not thinking mid-performance, oh, this is a difficult part coming up. Am I going to get it? I would like that every performer practice their piece until they know they're going to get it, or at least be 90% sure. Oh yeah, I'm going to nail this thing because I played it 20 times in a row this week. So this is the level one. Again, everybody can do this part. The level two is stage presence. And I feel like this is where a lot of, especially in the Ocarina community, performers don't focus on this as much. And I have become fascinated with how people present themselves on stage with the Ocarina. So what is stage presence? Stage presence is just how we present ourselves on stage, or it's being mindful about what we're doing on stage beyond the music. What faces am I making? Am I playing with my eyes open or closed? What's my body doing? Am I moving on the stage? Am I making eye contact with people? These are things that people don't even think about. And it's important for the audience member. Like, it's one thing to hear it, but going to see you perform in person, you have the opportunity to make a connection with them by giving them a performance and giving them another layer of something that they can't just hear on Spotify or listen to on YouTube. So I think this deserves some extra attention for that reason. So the number one question I would ask is, what am I communicating through my performance? Am I playing the ocarina like this? What does this position say to you? If you see an ocarina player playing like this, what do you think in your head? Bad camera angle. What else? They're shy. Yes. They didn't get enough caffeine in the morning. Fair. Tight, stiff. Exactly. But what if you see the ocarina doing something like how about that? Thumbnail posing. Fair. Relax. They have poor posture. It's a completely different thing that I'm communicating. Maybe more confidence, focus. I'm really in the music. I'm relaxed. So even just something as simple as posture is important. I'm just going to put these up here real quick. Let's see. Yeah, these are the goals of having a good stage presence. So connecting with your audience, creating a memorable experience, and having fun. Because if you're so focused on the music of whether or not you're going to mess it up, or if you're playing well, like, it's really difficult to have fun in that position. So what I want to do now is I actually want to show you three performances that I really love, and I want to break them down and have a discussion about what you guys notice about these ocarina players. I hope you can hear this. So let me know if you do not.
We can't hear it, but if you send them to me, I'm very happy to play them.
It's fine. Let's actually just look at their performances. What do you guys notice? He is, yeah. He looks confident performing as he shows his passion, yes. Comfort on stage, those are all perfect responses. Yes, he looks cool. He's having fun, he's loose, he's relaxed. He could be doing this in his living room and no one would know. I love his what I'm going to call stage blocking, which is when you take advantage of the space. Sometimes this isn't possible because as performers, we're stuck behind a microphone. And so we have a limited pocket that we can move, but he actually has a mouthpiece so that he can just move around the stage. And we could talk a little bit more about this, but I was really impressed because I really rarely see ocarina players do this. Next up we have Osawa Satoshi. Again, I'm sorry you can't hear it, but it's actually besides the point. All right, what do you notice? energy. Yes. Very lively, yes. It seems like he's feeling the emotions of the music. Ask yourself why. Why does it seem like why he feels the emotions of the music? Especially without hearing the music. This is probably better actually that you can't hear it, because now you are judging purely on their stage presence. His face is expressive. Yes. There are more face muscles working than finger muscles. That's good. All right, great, one more. This is probably my favorite of the three. This is Mikako Honya, and I think she wins the award for cutest ocarina performance. Let's see what she does. You can't hear it, but the audience is clapping along. While the band is vamping. What else? What else do you notice? Yes, Brad, exactly. I wish you could hear this though, because I'm jamming. Look at her. Look, she looks happy, cheeky looks. Yes, she is excited and she's making eye contact and she's very expressive. Exactly, she's making eye contact. So all these things are important skills that you can utilize to connect with your audience and give a good performance. That's some skills that she's able to keep that much breath control while moving her whole body. Body movement is also important, as we could also see with the Osawa. I can't move my feet while I play it. All right, perfect. So this is how you actually do all those things that we just saw in those performances. Number one, you have to be very familiar with the music. If you are focused on the music, you cannot focus on the audience. It's as simple as that. You actually probably should memorize your music at this point. So that way, everything that you do with the ocarina is all second nature. I know this so well, it's not a second thought for me. I'm just gonna focus on what I'm doing with my body and with my face and the audience and being present in the moment. So for this part, I would give yourself, you have to plan this out when you're preparing for a performance. I would give yourself a limited amount of time for memorizing and working on the music. You can brush up on it leading up to the performance, but spend a good amount of time in the first half of the preparation just getting to know the music. And then second thing that you can do that's really easy mid-performance is just make eye contact, like we saw with Mikako. And I think as an introvert, this part gives me some anxiety. Because I think today it's very difficult to connect with people, just like walking down the street. And what do we do when we block eyes for a second? We avert our eyes quickly, like, oh, I don't want to do that. But it's culturally, it is challenging, but I think it is so beautiful to make a connection, even if you're just making eye contact like that. And it's the easiest thing that you can do for performance. Posture and facial expressions. Osawa is extremely good at this. And I know just being aware of what your body is doing in the moment and making a conscious decision. I'm not gonna slouch in the performance. I'm gonna puff my chest out a little bit, drop my shoulders back. And this is, again, something you can practice every single day. So that way, that's also second nature when you get on stage. But the facial expressions, that's something that you might actually have to stand in front of a mirror and just see what is possible with the ocarina. Like if you have the ocarina, there's a couple of easy things you can do. You can smile with your eyes, which we all learned how to do in the pandemic with the face mask, which is just So even if I did this, you can tell that I'm smiling. So doing that with the ocarina, or the easiest one is furrowing your brow. And what does that communicate to you if I'm like, it's like intense, right? So just little things that you could do like that. And don't be cheesy about it. I think try to be as natural as you can. And it also depends on the song, of course. Like with Makako, you couldn't hear it, but it was a very cheerful song. And so she's able to do more along the lines with that. But if it's a more intense or somber or sad song, obviously you don't want to be dancing around on stage. Blocking, as I mentioned, that Milt was doing, which is where you were intentionally going to an area of the stage. Maybe it's to connect with a certain group in the audience. So, and that's what I would recommend, that you would, if you're going to be utilizing a stage in this way, that you are not just going here and then, okay, I did this, now I'm gonna go here, and then I did that, I'm gonna go there. No, you have to have intention behind it. And if you're gonna approach a group of people or a person in particular, that you use that opportunity to connect with that person. So making eye contact, spending a little bit of time with the music there, and then move to a second point, and try to do this as much in advance to their performance, just thinking, okay, this section of the song, I'm gonna spend some time there. It's a little more complicated, but it also depends on your technical abilities, microphone wise. Storytelling, this is another really easy way to, that's true, unless cheesy is your shtick. This is how I've been able to get, I think, the biggest response from people is when I tell people about the music I'm about to perform, what the song means to me, how I wrote the song. There's a song that I wrote called Golden Fields, and it's one of my favorites to perform because I like to tell the story of how one day I was, I'll just briefly tell the story here. So the song was inspired by a trip that I took with my brother, whom I had recently reconnected with. And it was a very emotional trip because we hadn't spoken to each other in years. And so I was really just soaking in this time that I was getting to speak with him. And I just, one day he was driving and I was in the passenger seat and we were in the Midwest of the United States, and just driving through this open road surrounded by these golden fields of wheat. And I just started strumming something on the ukulele, and it just beautifully captures that moment in time and the emotion I was feeling. Me sharing that story instantly makes people invested into, oh, I wanna feel what he was feeling in that moment. That sounds like it meant a lot to him. And they're kind of swished away into this experience. And so being able to share stories like that in a medium where we don't usually talk, playing the ocarina, I think it really helps to connect people with what you're doing mid-performance. And then what Mikako did really beautifully was the audience engagement. This is also a little bit challenging depending on how musically inclined your audience is. With the clapping in particular, I've tried it, and sometimes it's been gone really well, and sometimes it's a little bit confusing as a performer. But then there's dancing. I wrote a song called 4151, which is the numbers of the chords. So the four chord, one chord, or five chord, one chord, or the tonics of the root notes of those chords. And so whenever I have ocarina players in the audience, I would ask them to play F, C, G, C during the chorus, and it works out beautiful for participation. And then any questions about this in particular before I move on to this next part? That sounds like fun. Leo asks, is there a microphone that we can bring on the stage that can be mounted to us to do stage blocking? Yes, I have it's a lavalier headset. So a lavalier mic it's a wireless microphone system. Usually it's a battery pack connected to a receiver, and then you can have a little microphone that goes here. You've probably seen it like at a church service or at a meeting. But they also have a headpiece version. And I have one by Audio Technica. It's a couple years old, but that headpiece connects to the lavalier pack. and it allows me to move on stage, which I believe is also what Milt was using there. So you can look up lavalier mic or lav mic, but it's the actual systems are pretty expensive. So if you wanted to invest and you were going to a place that had a lavalier system, you could just buy the headset, but I bought the whole system. Okay, this is kind of the last part of the presentation. And I just wanted to touch on this because I think if you struggle with stage present or stage fright and you have anxiety about performing, this is one of the easiest and best ways to get used to performing. If you don't have open mics in your area, or if you don't have a lot of performance opportunities, I would say that street busking is it's easy because everyone has like a town center or a market, and all you have to do really is bring your ocarina and maybe a little sound system, a speaker, a Bluetooth speaker, and just go out and play. I used to play at my college. I play here in California, and I used to play back in San Antonio too. But the first thing that I would do is ask yourself, what is my goal for the street performing? If it is getting over the stage fright, don't think about how you're performing, like the equipment and whether or not you have the right instruments. Just go do it, because the goal is quantity. You want to have a lot of experience with performing for people to get over the stage fright. If your goal is to earn money and make a living from it, then you have to invest a little bit more into what you are, your equipment, but then also your show, your stage presence, and how you are playing your music. Public parts is also a good spot, Jolene. That's good. So the first question I would ask after what's my goal is it legal, as someone just pointed out. So you have to check with your local town's ordinances if they require a permit or not. Most actually Los Angeles city areas do not require a permit, except for Santa Monica. They have a large busking scene, and so to regulate it, you do have to have a permit. Same in Seattle, you have to have a permit, and as well as in New York, and I think in Chicago too. So it's just because of the competition. There's so many people trying to get really good spots that it is difficult to regulate. So that's why they did that. But again, check that out first, because you don't want to get in trouble. I tried busking in New York once and I got busted by the cops, and that is not recommended. And then location too, like I just said, that it can be so competitive to find a really good location. So you have to scout out, like, what are the busy walkways? Are there other buskers here? What are those busker schedules? And am I going to be disturbing anybody, really? Maybe you don't want to be right outside of a really busy shop, but you could stand on the street across from the busy shop, or on the street corner next to a busy shop. Just make sure that you are not risking getting in trouble or blocking a heavy walk space. I think you want to be safe disturbing the local ducks. And then I don't want to tell you, I don't want to explain it here, the stuff that I use, but I'll just point out what I'm using here in this picture. So this is my particular setup. What you don't see is I also have a 5-gallon bucket with my social media, and usually I have a funny message on the bucket. And it just encourages people to drop something in there. So you need some sort of a collection tool. It could be a bucket, it could be a jar, a box. I also used to have this old suitcase that I would put all this equipment in, and I just opened the suitcase. And then I have the sound system at the bottom, which I don't remember the brand, but it is I think it's Bose, actually not Bose. It could be Boss. And then I have the microphone, the cable. I sometimes bring out an effects pedal. I have this that little white arm that's holding my phone because I also like to simultaneously stream to TikTok or sometimes Instagram, just so I can double my efforts with the connecting with an audience, but also getting tips. And then I have a bottle of water and some usually some snacks. So that's really all that you need. I do have a QR code, yes. You can talk to the shops as well, yes, to get their permission, just to make sure. Any questions about busking? I haven't busked in a couple weeks. It's gotten really competitive in my area. There in up in Glendale, which is where I am, we have our regulars, which is like, there's a country singer, there's a cello player, there's me, sometimes there's a guitar player or two. But recently we've had a kind of a wave, as things have gotten cooler, of singer-songwriters. And we have a limited amount of really nice spots. So I'm just like, you guys can have it for now. So yeah, but if you want to catch me busking, follow me on TikTok. And usually I always stream there. Do you think it's a good idea to use MIDIs for backtracks? I personally don't like it. I don't like the MIDI sound, but what I sometimes will do is I'll take the MIDI and I will convert it with like GarageBand or Logic and make the sound instruments sound more real. Have you gotten requests to perform at a private event from people who approached you while busking? Yes. Once or twice. Once I got invited to a wedding, and another time I got invited to perform in Glendale. They were having an event. When you approach the shop owners, if they never had buskers before, there's a chance they may be defensive by default. When you ask for permission and they want to stay on the safe side, how would you approach the owners to warm up the conversation and skip the stranger part? Ooh, that's a great question. I actually have not had that experience, so I'm not sure how to answer that. I guess it's just being honest, like, hi, maybe you can show them a recording of what you do on your phone. And just say, this is what I do. Would you mind if I did it in front of your shop? I've gotten a lot of good attention in the past and it might actually help your business. That's what might sound good. Yes, Jolie and I there's so many karaoke tracks on Spotify. So if you're a Spotify subscriber, or if you have if you're subscribed on YouTube, not subscribe, if you have the premium service, I would say be careful for both, that you avoid the commercials, because that's annoying. So if you pay for Spotify or the YouTube thing, do that so you don't have commercials. Okay, great. If you guys have more questions about any of this, you guys can text me, but I just have one more bit that I wanted to share. And that is that the goal of every performance, and this is something you can just remind yourself, whether it's playing on the street or playing on a stage or at an open mic, is to be present in the moment and connect with your audience. Be present and connect. Those two things should be your goals. If you do those two things, you're going to have more fun. The audience is going to have more fun, and you are going to potentially have new supporters and people who are going to want to follow you and listen to more of your music because of that connection and because your performance meant something to them. So be present and connect. This is also great for life when you are in a relationship or you have family and friends. Be present and connect. This is a very therapeutic session. And then I just want to leave you with this one story. I don't know if Fabio's still here and if he'll remember this, but in 2015, I was invited to perform at the Budrio Festival. And that was the same year that I think Songbird Ocarina was there. And so I was helping at the booth and in the market, but I had a performance on the Saturday afternoon. And so I needed to go back to my hotel to change and then make my way back to the church. And it was about, I don't know, like a half a mile walk from the market to the to the hotel where I was staying, and I lost track of time. So maybe like 45 minutes before my performance, I was like, oh shoot, I need to go back to the hotel and change. So I ran to the hotel, and then I changed really quick, as quickly as I could. And then I ran back to the church, and I was so flustered that I didn't really know where I was supposed to go. So I went to the front of the church and opened the doors, and the audience was already in there, and they all turned around and looked at me, and I just slowly closed the doors. And I was sweating. I'm sure I looked like a mess. And I was like, shoot, how do I get in there? Because I think someone was about to perform. So then I saw there was a side entrance, and I ran upstairs, and then I found the entrance to the stage. And I was just like breathing heavily. And it was on the second level. And Fabio was there. And I think he thought I was nervous about my performance, but really I was out of breath from running back and forth. And he was like, David, it's okay. Your performance is going to be great. I'm so excited to hear you play. And then he said something to the effect of, I want you to remember that performing is a gift. You're gifting a piece of yourself through the music, and they're gifting you with their time, attention, and applause. And that has really stuck with me through the years. Really, I kind of needed to hear that because I was not present. I was so like out of breath and everything. And I just think that this is really beautiful for remembering that what you're doing is a gift, and what you're sharing is beautiful. And what the audience is sharing is meaningful and beautiful as well. And they're there to support you and listen to you and enjoy what you're gifting them. So remember that, screenshot that. I hope this was meaningful to you. And on this note, please go listen to all of our performers today and tomorrow. I'm playing tomorrow, so you're gonna see if I put all these things into practice myself. But if you're a performer, definitely try to use some of these techniques. I'd love to see some of these stage present techniques in your performances as well. If there are any questions, I can take those real quick, and then I'm gonna go drink some coffee.
That was a really awesome presentation, David. I was having really good time listening to it, and I'm really thankful for the wisdom. I took a picture. A lot of people are saying, oh, I took a screenshot. Great quote. Fabio's a pocket of wisdom. All these things, they're fantastic. So thank you so much for sharing, man. We really appreciate you.
Leo asked, what was my first experience on stage? That's a great question. I had extreme stage fright, and I was probably, how old was I? 14. And I was taking piano lessons from this guy who had a music school, and I was playing I Will Remember You by Sarah McLachlan on piano. And I was so nervous that I played the first like phrase of notes, and I froze. And this was probably about maybe 50 or 60 people in the room, fairly small recital room. And I just blanked. And this is the worst thing that could happen to you as a performer. Luckily it was just me, so I could pick right up when I snapped out of it. But I'll never forget that feeling of just like, oh no, I forgot everything. And then luckily I snapped back into it. Thank you, Fabio. And I have so many horror stories of performances gone wrong. Like there was the time that I got hired to perform at this convention in Austin, Texas. And it was a retro video game convention, and this was my second time doing it, and I spent so much time preparing everything for it that I got in my car, I drove from San Antonio to Austin, and I forgot my ocarinas, and it's about a 90-minute drive, but I didn't realize I forgot my ocarinas until about an hour before my performance, and there was no way I would make it back. So luckily I had some plastic ocarinas for sale at my booth, but man, that was embarrassing. I had to make some adjustments to the set list. Sam asked, how do you actually put yourself out there, even just for busking? I go on walks just to find isolated spots where I can play without the risk of passerbys. That is a great question. And like I said, it takes a lot of courage to do any sort of playing in front of people. I still get nervous when I get busking. And I'm like, okay, here's the hardest part is just starting. I can tell you that every single time. Because my mind is like, oh, these people here, they're not expecting the ocarina. They're going to give me an ugly look. And I really don't want to receive an ugly look. And I don't want to hear them whispering like, oh, what was that? But I just focus on putting on a good performance. And usually, I don't think I've ever, maybe once or twice, gotten a response like that. Even a confident performer's experience stage fright. You get better at managing with experience. Yes, that is extremely true. The more that you play, the easier it gets. And I've heard that across the board for everybody. So just doing it, whatever nerves you're feeling, recognize that you're feeling them, and then just reassure yourself, they're gonna go away. I'm gonna just focus on making people happy. And that I think has gotten me through most performances. Okay, I did what I could to prepare. I'm just gonna focus on making people happy. And usually I do. That Leo said, that happened to me too. I forgot my ocarinas when I wanted to perform a birthday gift for a friend. Gladly, I was able to just skip it. Well, I was being paid for my event, so I couldn't just skip it, but I pulled through. Luckily, like I spent some time with those plastic ocarinas before, so I made it happen. Stefan said, when I started busking, it actually made me more anxious finding the spot than the performance itself. Yeah, when here where I busk, it's so stressful trying to find a spot where someone else isn't playing, or there's not a lot of noise, or like, and then once I find the spot, I'm like, okay, now I can just set up and focus on playing. When you performed, you also have a jukebox in your head that you're playing along with. If yes, has it ever happened where your jukebox just starts during the performance or doesn't start before the performance? No, so this also goes back to just practicing. I have a set list of, I can actually show you the songs that I perform live with. So I have a playlist. I have a bunch of songs downloaded to my phone, but I have a Spotify playlist too of songs that I play with. And I always spend at least 30 minutes with each song before I go busking. So this is, I guess it's backwards and my phone is blaring it. It says karaoke busking. And the two really great audio makers are Sing to Piano, Sing the number two in piano, and Sing to Guitar. And they make so many pop playlists that I have them all saved. So it makes it really easy. Okay, great, it's not backwards. When you perform so frequently, do you get tired of playing some songs so many times? Yeah, so I think with the busking, I like that I don't need to have a playlist really. Like I have this list of songs, but I usually just go with what I'm feeling. Like if it starts to become nighttime, I'll put on slower songs, and there's usually like maybe 10 songs I have on rotation at a time. So yeah, and then I mix it up. Like when I'm live streaming, I'll say, okay, we're gonna play video game music, and then I pull up that playlist, or we're gonna play pop music and I pull up that playlist. So I don't get super tired of it, but I do know that there's songs that usually get money and that resonate with people. So I might play those a little more often. These are great questions, everybody. I would probably have a few more minutes before we got to go, but any advice on how to get more practice in when you can't get a lot of privacy? Yeah, that's a little bit more challenging, but as Jolene said, you have parks. You could find, if you go to school or you have practice rooms at a local college. Yes, Nicholas.
I have an idea for this one that I was really testing out recently. There's places in certain local libraries that let you rent out rooms for free.
Oh, yes.
And they let you just reserve those. And it's like, if you're not affiliated with a college of music, it's hard to go in and use their music rooms, especially if you don't have a college in your area. But one idea that I've been kind of workshopping this semester is kind of just going to a library and asking, hey, do you have any empty rooms, or do you have any rooms that I can reserve on a weekly basis or on a consistent basis? And that kind of helps. And like Jolene had said, Mr. Mute is also a really good resource. If you guys know Mr. Mute, is David can probably explain it better.
Yeah, so it's just a device that Milt released that can attach to most ocarinas. And all it does is it mutes your ocarina. It's a little complicated to figure out what works best for your ocarina, but it comes with all these different attachments that you can try out. But it's just a really good resource when you can't have a dedicated spot. But libraries, I actually just realized that our local libraries do have spaces you can rent out for free, which is incredible. So thank you for bringing that one up. Looking through your questions. How many ocarinas do I bring to a performance? I typically stick to no more than four, depending on the occasion. So it's usually a double alto C, and then an alto C, a soprano G, and an alto G. Most of the music I can get by with just an alto C or a double alto C. But also because I like to have a mini presentation in my performances. So I'm like, and this is a soprano G and this is a double ocarina. I think it's great to have a couple different ones on hand. Did I miss anything? Great question, Stephen. Do you prefer doing performances memorized or with sheet music? And how do you practice memorization skills? That is a really good question as well. So if it's a more technical piece or a new piece, if I'm learning it for that specific performances, I like to have the sheet music with me. If it's a piece that I've played in the past or if I've spent some time, because I want to have a better presence on stage, I will memorize it. But you can also have stage presence with sheet music in front of you, like Osawa was doing. I think you just have to be more intentional about not staying locked on the sheet music. Because this was something that I didn't really mention that I meant to. The connecting with your audience is so important to having them part of that experience. And when your eyes are constantly closed, and I've seen a lot of ocarina players do this, including myself, it's hard to let people in. It just really is hard for them to connect with you with your eyes constantly closed. So if I could recommend one thing for everybody, it's just to be more conscious of what you're doing with your eyes, with your eyebrows, but also with your actual eyes. And not playing, I challenge you all to not play with your eyes closed so much. For the memorizing tips, it's just repetition. I would break it down into chunks. Like if it's a pop song, I'm gonna memorize the verse today, tomorrow, or the next couple of days, I'm gonna focus on the chorus, and then just do that. Break it down into chunks, it's the easiest way. What is your opinion on performing ocarina a cappella? It can be nice. I think I like having more context of the piece with a karaoke track or a piano or a guitar. I love harmony, and I think that adds something to it. But I think that solo ocarina can be really beautiful. Let's do two more questions. What is your favorite place to perform ocarina music at, and why is it church? That's a great question. I like to I guess if I'm being completely honest, I like to just play like in the forest and in the woods for myself. That's not really, it's kind of a cheating answer because it's not really performing, but that's where I like to play the most. I guess for performing, I really like being on stage. Like it feels good as a performer. Like, okay, I have their captured attention for 3 to 10 minutes. And this is my opportunity as an introvert to share my story. And I think as introverts, we often don't get a lot of time to be that deep of a level. So I think that's why it's so really nice to me. That could be in the church. It could be at a convention. It doesn't matter. Matt asked, this will be the last question. Have I ever played with an ensemble backing track? No, not really. The way that I do my arrangements is the melody usually weaves in between the ocarina. So it's a little more challenging to play with an ensemble backing track, but that's just my particular arrangements.
All right. Well, yeah. I just want to say thank you, a huge thank you to David. So if you could join me in the comments and join me in thanking David, because I know that you guys are probably saying it out loud, but I want him to be able to hear it and see it would be great. But I want to say a huge thank you to David for coming out and having this presentation, both to David and Fabio. It was such an entertaining, insightful, and informative morning. It felt like we just got a lot of like really good information, especially for everybody on whatever scale of the ocarina journey you're on, whether you're just starting, you just are joining us just from the Songbird newsletter that was out today, or whether you have been playing for years and like you're just looking for ways to make your playing more meaningful and add more meaningfulness to your music. So I just want to say thank you to both panelists today, and don't forget to check out David's concert tomorrow. That's gonna be so exciting. I can't wait to hear it. And yeah, we will be back at 1 p.m. With Songbird's panel. They will be doing a panel showcasing some of their ocarina. So we will see you back at 1 p.m. We're going to take a very quick 1 hour break and then we'll be back. Thank you again, David. We'll see you soon.
Thank you, Nicholas. Thanks, everybody.